I genuinely thought that talking just the way that we do would have been enough.
Yes, but let's introduce it. Like, let's get the intro out of the way, and then we can just blabber. And actually, I'll probably end up editing it.
If you're watching this on YouTube, know that this was actually live streamed. So what you should have done was to follow us on YouNow, which you will find the link down here. If you're actually watching us on YouNow right now, well, here's why we're here. Basically, we have been thinking about doing a podcast for a while.
We attempted one version of it that we never got around to filming again.
Yeah.
But just because I think that it was kind of dated and personal, whereas the internet loves things to be fresh and new.
Yeah. And the point also, I think, this might actually be a record club. This might be the new version of record club, which was our podcast.
I'll come up with a different name of it. I'll come up with a different name for it. Something to do with tonic.
Why?
Gin and tea goes gin and tonic.
Okay. Tonic in tea. In tea packs.
Mug of tonic. Lambrini in a mug.
I think Magda has some sort of copyright on that.
Lambrini in a mug?
Yeah.
She stole it from 2 pints of lager and a packet of crisps. Well, it's just a chavvy thing to do, Lambrini in a mug.
Okay.
But yeah.
That's why you did it so proudly.
Yeah. No, yeah, it's a thing. Like, because, yeah, there's a TV show, 2 packets of lager and a pint of crisps. 2 pints of lager and a packet of crisps, which was about Scousers. Not quite Scousers, they live south of Liverpool.
Okay.
But they were complete chavs and, like, hideous people. It was like Always Sunny in Philadelphia, but set in Liverpool.
We're derailing from the subject.
Immediately. So for the hen party, their like celebratory drink is not champagne. They drink Lambrini in a mug with a straw. Hence, that's why like you come home with Lambrini. Like, oh look, I got this. I go, that's so full of sugar. You can't drink that.
Ew.
But I'll have it in a giant mug.
What you hear in the background is Jeff Buckley. Why did we end up with Jeff Buckley? I'm still not quite. No, I remember the trick, the train of track mind.
I thought I was drunk.
I have a very strong empathy, even when other people are drunk and I don't drink. The friends team in different versions.
Well,
the Radiohead version of the Pokemon team.
And then I started ranting about how Radiohead and Muse wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Jeff Buckley, because he invented the vocal elasticity of going low and high at the same time.
And it's still, they haven't managed to get there. Like, they try, they clearly are inspired, but they didn't quite get there.
No, so the point is, Jeff Buckley can skip an octave on the note, whereas everyone else who tries to do so does like a third to a fifth, or they skip a few, and there's always a break in the voice, and he just goes, well, I think the night has an overarching theme, which has been going on for a few days for me, which I think I've been kind of dragging you along, which is honesty through art. And it comes from 2 weeks ago, so, you know, I go to Hub Festival, and we write my interview questions, and the best question we had on that list was, well, you started off as, do you think it's true what Oscar Wilde said, give a man a mask and he'll speak the truth? And personally, I think there's a much more succinct way to say that, which is,
mine is just artistic. Like,
it is artistic.
Just when you say, when you name Oscar Wilde, people, usually musicians, when they were coming back at me listening to the questions, were like, oh, so that we are in that kind of artsy poetry feeling that we're all in together. So it's a name you drop. That is a name drop, not the name drops that I do, that you claim I do.
That you don't do. My issue is the name drops that you don't do. But yeah, so you have that point, which it's very, very artsy, and it establishes you as the kind of interviewer that you are.
Yeah, we talk the same language. That's the point.
Whereas
trying to establish with them.
What you've established with me interviewing is that I'm one of the guys, I'm one of the band.
Yeah.
So my version of that question is much more personal, which is, do you find it easier to tell the truth through your music than you would to say speaking to your family and friends. Now that was always that was the favorite question of every band I answered. I spoke to, like, they were always like, oh my god, these questions are so deep, that's so cool. Cut Ribbons were like, I'm so glad we did that interview, man, because like everyone always asks the same questions, like, oh, who are your inspirations, what's the next album about, is it anything to do with anything at home, kind of stuff like that. And you know, we're asking these philosophical questions, like, this is so refreshing.
You're welcome.
Yeah, exactly. And but that theme has followed over kind of coincidentally, because Nick Cave
yesterday
released his movie, and today released his new album.
The album of Skeleton Tree, and the movie is One More Time with Feeling.
One More Time with Feeling. And the whole... I twigged it a month ago. I don't know why it didn't occur to me sooner, but it suddenly twigged me. We received some PR notice, and something in the PR, I just read something in it, and it told me that this film and this album is about his son dying. The whole point of this album and this film is because he doesn't know how to deal with grief in any other way than to write. So this happened, and he just started writing. And he just started working, and he started working through it. And he poured everything that he was feeling into his music and into this film. And then about a week after I kind of tweaked that, then we get the PR email with the trailer for the film. And he talks about in this trailer, and it's a scene from the movie, which is... We haven't seen yet, we're going to go see it tomorrow. There's a scene from the movie where he's talking about how everyone tries to put on a mask and kind of look in the mirror and doesn't quite see who they are. But there's still, you know, there's still something to them. Like, no matter how much they try to be someone else, they can always still see themselves in it. Until something happens that's so horrible and so tragic that it just changes you as a core, and you don't even recognize your own face. And as soon as that happened, I was like, okay, no, this is going to be something special. And of course, I have the Off the Record news show, which has been following the release of this album
pretty closely.
Since the first announcement that it was going to happen, it was the second video I personally ever made on Gin and Teacups. And it's now the most popular video we've made in
the last
2 years?
Yeah,
3 years?
Since we reopened, really.
And when I came to this realization, I was like, well, I should make a video about it. I should kind of, I don't know, out him. I should be like, okay, so this trailer, and it, like, clearly it has themes to do with the fact that his son died, and he's making this stuff about his son dying. And then I realized that I'm not a vulture.
You know, you have the same problem that I had at the... Not only at the beginning, like, at the beginning of Gin and Teacups, it felt like it was a problem. And then it became a conscious choice, because very early in the days of Gin and Teacups, I was given access to people that I shouldn't have been,
yeah.
to be completely fair. And one of the things is when I interviewed John Lesser, which is used to be at the time of Departure, the girlfriend of Jeff Buckley, which is, I think, one of the links that we got around Jeff Buckley. And she was my second interview for Gin and Teacups. And the reason I knew she existed, it's because she was Jeff Buckley's girlfriend and inspiration for songs. And as hard as it was, I didn't even remotely in the questions put anything about Jeff. And I was like, it's not something, if it's not something that you can bring something positive to, even if you're just asking a question and then you can go into introspective mode, but when it's about death, you don't. There is no way to bring anything good to it, unless you're close to this person that can actually help them, which is not the case. So when I was given the chance to interview her, I not even remotely brought it up. Not in general, is even about relationships and stuff. And at the end of it, she brought up the fact that this is the first interview that I did in 10 years where nobody asked me about Jeff, so thank you.
I mean, yeah, so that was the point, is that this is so clearly what's happening. And I'm about to make the video and suddenly it twigs at me like, it's not my place to report this.
Yeah.
It's his story. He should be the one that tells it. And if he comes out beforehand and he says outright that this is why he's doing it, I will report that he said it. I will not
say myself.
I will not take what is clearly something so personal to him and expose it to the world for my own personal gain. I grew up listening to this man. He has inspired my entire music listening, not career, but hobby, whatever. And I admire him completely. He is an idol to me. And so, no, I don't know why I feel such a personal connection to it, but it would be like...
No, that's...
You'd be like exposing someone's private messages. Because no one was talking about this, and I didn't want to be the first one to do it. And then, all of a sudden, in the last week, I think Tuesday is when the first article dropped, when it suddenly comes out, like, this entire film exists so that he didn't have to speak to journalists. And as soon as that one article dropped, every single newspaper... and every single music magazine started to report exactly the same thing. And, you know, there's a part of me going, okay, I missed out. Like, I could have been the first one to make this thing.
I know,
but
it's a tricky thing.
But no, I wouldn't do that. And, I mean, I just want to say, like, this live stream, this isn't about that. This is, I'm just giving you, you know, background to the kind of theme for the conversations we've been having in the past few days. Because truth through art has been... very thematic. So, I mean, do you want to talk about what we just went to tonight?
How? I don't know how.
Okay, so, well, all right, I'll do it then. So,
if you have any, if you have managed to put it into words, by all means.
So, Ginger has a very good friend, Annie, who's been, I mean, she's a, Ginger's one of those weird people who becomes friends with the fans, so if you want to become friends, get in touch.
Because you're not fans, you just happen to be in the same time and space as Sherry with me, so... Yeah, it's not a celebrity thing, it's not fans, it's people that actually have something, I suppose, in common with me, they feel, or with us now,
yeah.
If you're here watching, so yeah, you should drop me a line, anyway.
So Annie... met this absolutely beautiful Australian man who, I don't know, is he studying there?
Yeah, he was studying at the...
So he's studying at the Royal Academy of Music in...
Composition.
No, what's the street, what's the area?
Marylebone.
Marylebone, so Baker Street?
Yeah.
Yeah, so Royal Academy of Music in Baker Street. And tonight he put on a... he said it was a recital, but it wasn't a recital, it was an art performance.
An art performance, yeah.
He composed the music, and he paired it with three different art pieces. And the whole point was whether or not you can convey the same message through a piece of artwork that you can through music. Does it come across? Like, can you tell this is the same thing? And he hired us to film the thing because his cameraman pulled out the last second. We were going anyway, and so yeah, we just brought our cameras along, and I got to annoy everyone by like jumping in front and getting the camera out.
But at least you have it for posterity.
Yeah, and the video's gonna look amazing. So this first piece, like the flute player pulled out at the last second, so he ended up playing a recording. And I hadn't checked beforehand, but the song pieces were correlated by numbers to the art installations. And so I'm listening to this piece, and I'm trying to stay out of the way of everyone, because everyone's kind of looking at these art pieces. I'm like, okay, can I tell which art piece it was? And there's one, it was very obvious, because one of the art pieces was a picture of a house that had been photocopied multiple times, so that...
Like, every photocopy was the original for the new photocopy.
So it's photocopied over and over again, the copy was photocopied. And so, of course, you end up with, like, JPEG artifacts, and it degrades every time you do it. And it was very clear that that was being put forward through the music, because the flute playing is getting distorted. Now, not in a digital sense, like the player was distorting what they were playing. It was incredible. I don't even know how you would write that in musical notation, like go brrrr as you're playing a flute. I don't even know how you
just
do that.
Start to speed into your flute until it sounds like a tornado is coming.
And so, yeah, suddenly we've had this we've been having these discussions about, okay, how are we going to deal with the Nick Cave thing? Because everyone else is talking about it. We haven't seen the movie yet. We haven't listened to the album yet, because we want to listen to the album when we watch the movie.
Yet.
And yet, suddenly we go to this art installation that is doing exactly what we're talking to, where they're delivering a message so concisely through the music, and it's so clear what they're talking about. And of course, there's free wine. And then with free wine, we come back, we're talking about it, I get more wine. And so that's when we end up on like, oh yeah, by the way, last night someone did Friends theme in 9 different songs, 9 different genres, and we go through that. And how do we get from Friends?
We get Friends from Pokemon Dawn, the Radiohead way.
Oh yeah, so
Tom York
then,
clearly is inspired in his singing style, as much database, by Jeff Buckley. We went on to Jeff. With Grace, because we both listened to it the same distorted way. And then we went on to Surreal, because I made the first sound for your text message from that. And then I wrote up, one of the things like, I still wonder how John survives Jeff, which is one of the things that I used to say for years. And then I realized, but Rob doesn't know the background to this. And I was like, okay, did I ever mention that one of the people that I interviewed was Joan Wasser, which used to be Jeff Buckley's girlfriend at the time? And you went almost upset. I'm sorry.
So, I mean, a bit of backstory for that. So, the first time we meet, you tell me that, I'm a music journalist of sorts. Like, I freelance as a music journalist.
I do.
You did. I have this YouTube account and stuff. And our first few dates for the first couple of months, actually, you ended up using your prowess in the musical industry to get us free entry to these really cool events.
Like, I don't use it. They invited me, and I was like, it sounds like a cool thing.
True.
Let's go.
Like, I think the biggest memory I had was when we went to the Red Bull-sponsored event that had the Lebanese bluegrass rock band, the Wanton Bishops. They were absolutely unbelievably incredible.
Okay, like,
for the launch of the documentary. so we have this, and I don't know, over the course of a few months it suddenly kind of eked out. Like, you didn't brag about being kind of like, oh yeah, I'm so cool, I hang out with all these people.
No, you don't.
At all.
That's one of the few things that I think I've learned, and it's really important for me not to do. Because if you do this for the glitter and to drop names, you're doing this for the wrong reasons.
Yeah. However, you did, the way you kind of understated it to me, kind of told me that there was like quite a lot to it. Like, oh no, you had so many fans. And you told me about, like, I think in the first couple weeks you're going out, you had that stalker who invited you to go on a holiday throughout anywhere in Europe. So
it's
like,
again, it's not something that, it just happened at the same time.
Yeah.
We were together, so I told you.
So I'm like getting this idea of this kind of influence you have in the London music industry. And then you start saying things like, I'm going to go to a play with my friend Harry, that my friend Harry is performing in Notting Hill Gate. I got a spare ticket. Do you want to come with me? I'm like, yeah, sure. And then on the night we arrive there, and I'm suddenly watching this play and realizing that's Harry Lloyd. That's Viserys from Game of Thrones.
The dragon!
That's the evil family member from Doctor Who, who you described to me as your friend Harry.
Again, his friend is a strong word anyway.
Well, you hung out with him a fair few times.
A strong word.
And then it comes out that, oh yeah, no, your friend Carl is Carl Barrett from the Libertines. One time you went to a party with Carl to Benedict Cumberbatch's flat.
No, that wasn't Carl.
It wasn't Carl, was it? That was Carl. You didn't meet Benedict, but no, you're in his flat. You're in his flat with him. You just never spoke to him. And I thought we got through this. I thought we were done with the name drops. Like,
I don't name drop.
I know, not the I know, not name dropping, but I thought we were done with the hidden name drops, the name drops you weren't dropping. And then suddenly, it turns out that my number two idol in music, Jeff Buckley, who taught me more about playing guitar than any guitar teacher could ever hope to teach anyone.
What are your dad?
My dad plays bass.
Yeah, but still.
He wrote a few songs for me and kind of showed me a few different styles in kind of bass style playing, so kind of slap bass and But no, so when I was 14, he challenged me. I think he just discovered Jeff Buckley or something, or he just got the album and he's listened to it and goes, and he's amazed by it. So he actually, like, he looks into the history of it. And he reads all these quotes of people of, like, amazing guitarists that go to see Jeff Buckley live, and they come back with, like, I have no idea what this man is doing to his guitar. Like, clearly I don't know how to play guitar. And so he challenged me, like, okay, if you really want to play guitar, if you want to be good at guitar, learn a Jeff Buckley song.
Fair enough.
And I looked into it when I was 14 and went, fuck that. I don't know what any of these things are. They don't make any sense. It's like Phoebe in Friends teaching Joey how to play guitar. Like, okay, now do Crooked Grandma, Bear Claw. And I was completely bewildered. And then I think by the age of 16, I started listening to it from 14, and, you know, through the age of 15, I'm listening to this guy, and he's, you know, we talked this before in the Record Club podcast about, like, your first real favorite bands, and
yeah,
because you're a teenager when you get these first bands, you get these first favorite bands because you have such raw emotions, and the music really teaches you.
The same language.
The music really teaches you how to cope with and process these emotions, and Jeff Buckley was probably why I'm so messed up to this day, because he went a bit too far in teaching me those things as a teenager. And I just dedicate.
He's so passionate and so.
Exactly, but in a way, again, he has clear mental health problems, hence the drug abuse and eventual suicide.
Again, I have a different take on that. Like, I actually always had the perception that he's this life loving person to the point of, like, when the infamous sucking the marrow out of the bones kind of love for life, and it was just a moment of enthusiasm of whatever, and it just had, maybe it was a tiny bit high, I don't know, but the point is,
oh, he was on heroin.
He wasn't either trying to hurt himself or anything. He just, I think I can understand the feeling of, I don't know, being so overwhelmed by something beyond yourself, greater than yourself, that you do something like, I imagine the equivalent to be the walk in the Trevi Fountain in Rome. He happened to have the Mississippi there, but...
So, okay, running a little bit off track now. Well, on track with the current topic of conversation, but... Okay, so we always come back to BoJack Horseman. But, okay, I think you fell asleep, because you keep putting it on to fall asleep too, and you're missing so many amazing moments while you're asleep. But there's one episode in season one where he talks about... where he is trying to rewrite Diane's book. Because Diane basically slagged him off the entire book, and so he's trying to rewrite it. And he's rewriting it with... what's Aaron Paul's character's name? Todd.
Todd.
He's rewriting it with Todd and Sarah Lynn, and they're talking about the ending for the book, and it's like... Okay, so, I mean, you know, this is about your life. How would you end your life? How would you want your life to end? He goes, well, I always thought I'd go to Maine, you know, just settle down and relax. And then, you know, one day when everything was completely perfect and I was so very old that I didn't have any strength anymore, I would swim out into the lake knowing I would never come back. And so I like to think that's what happened with Jeff Buckley, is that he hit such great success. And everyone understood why he did it, why he played the music and who he was, and that's why he was so successful, that he just decided to take himself out on his prime in this very serene way. Was like, I'm gonna go for a swim where I know I'm not gonna be able to swim back.
Okay, when you say it like that, I understand the romantic view. I still hope that I can disagree with that, because no, he was working on his second album. That's why it's unfinished and it's so beautiful still, the few things that we get from it.
Well, he's also very, very high on heroin, which can be a very romantic drug. I can understand how that idea would come into his head.
And then again,
or he just got really depressed. I mean, maybe he did a Kurt Cobain. Maybe he just doubted himself so much. Like,
all could it be that he was actually so happy and joyous that he went to take this swim, he was still fully clothed, and he still had the metal boots, and the problem with those is that they drug you down because they're heavy. So when you go swimming, not with the boots.
might have noticed that on his way out.
No, I always had this perception, like, no, Jeff, don't go swimming with the boots.
I think someone's so emotional and so in touch with his emotions, and someone who exposes himself so well to the world with his emotions, I think that creates a very vulnerable person, and I can't imagine that scenario coming about any other way than suicidally. Whether it be a positive suicide of, I'm done, I have nothing more to give, or feeling like a fraud and a failure and seeing it as the only way out, I don't know, but personally I find it in a very melancholic sense to be much more beautiful to have him done it on purpose to end his life.
I mean, I suppose there is a level of meaning that it gives, at least that gives consolation in that sense. Maybe for the innocence of that even I can tell comes from him. There was always a feeling of no. It gives me the impression of the innocence of a child in a sense sometimes. And no,
it's not the innocence of a child. I completely disagree with that. Like, he has the emotional depth and maturity of a 17-year-old. Actually, to be fair,
but the rawness of emotion. It's like it's the complete emotion that you have when you.
I don't think you have so many complex emotions as you are a child. These are the things that come about as a teenager, and I think he struggled with these feelings and it stayed with him into his adult life. I know, I had many issues as a teenager that stuck with me until about 2 years ago. 2 or 3 years ago. Certain ones I still haven't dealt with. And that's why he still resonates with me now, as he did with me when I was a teenager.
I suppose at the end of the day, the point is,
what it means to you.
People, yeah.
I mean, that was the second question that everyone loves in our interviews is who has the final say on what a song means? Is it the writer who felt all these things, or is it up to the listener to decide what it means to them, which can sometimes be a lot more? And I think that works in acts, the things that people do throughout their lives. You can work out why they did it and try and understand why they did it, and you'll never really understand, but it's what it meant to you, what it inspired you to do, how it taught you to look at life.
It's also what you aspire to, I suppose.
Well, I definitely don't aspire to swim in the Mississippi with...
No, but... if you were to see that kind of struggle and suffer as a way to eventually get himself to express that kind of emotion in that beautiful way, that is something, in a way, to aspire for an artist, as you are, whether you like it or not.
I don't think anyone has... we haven't seen this movie, so a lot... back to Nick Cave. I've grown up on him. I know I was born after he existed, and I had to retrospectively listen to a lot of his stuff. But I grew up listening to him. And he's very good at storytelling.
Yeah.
However, in recent years, he's been telling his own story because suddenly he's lived this life that he feels is worth sharing. Previously, he drew inspirations from poets and westerns and horror writers and Stephen King to create these his songs are basically TV shows or movies in themselves.
I've never seen a tale. Well, Murder Ballads is the best example for me in that.
And suddenly recently he's stopped looking outwards to the world and he's closed himself off, and in closing himself off he's only had himself to look at, and so suddenly he's putting himself a lot more into this writing.
And he's actually leaving stuff.
Yeah.
He's not necessarily just doing his art, he's out doing things, but for his own self, for his family, for his life.
And he had a great quote in 20,000 Days on Earth, which is that marriage is cannibalism, or marriage as a writer is cannibalism, where you take everything that happens, all the fights and the loves and the woes, and you internalize them and you turn them into something else. You consume them and you produce something completely different. And that's a very, very stark change in his music and his poems. Like, he's kind of dabbled in poetry in the past, but he's kind of getting a lot more into it now. A lot of his songs feel like poetry.
Yeah, they always
He's just basically talking over these beautiful musical accompaniments. But then, you know, we listened to the teaser track, which was a clip from the movie. And suddenly he's just opening up his soul through his lyrics. And no one's ever really... He's always had this image of this, you know, very kooky, gothic... what was it the guy from Vice called him? A vampire who tames dragons.
Dragons, yeah.
And then suddenly he's like, no, this is the life I've lived. This is what's happened to me. This is... These are the consequences of the life that I lived, more importantly. And this is what happens in life with the talents that he has to expose that. And it's, I would say that this new album, this movie, from what I'm guessing, we haven't even seen it, we haven't listened to it, but what I'm getting from it so far, what's being put out there already, is that this is the most honest thing made since Jeff Buckley existed. Because no one else ever had the talent or the mental, emotional stability or capability to express themselves so clearly. Everything is always hidden behind metaphor and image. And I mean, you know, we're living in a day and age where people post their random thoughts on Facebook and Twitter without a second thought. Like, anything, you know, that internal monologue that goes inside your head, suddenly people are just typing that out as it comes.
That is something, though, that I agreed with you when you use. It's something that you said to me at the very beginning when we met, that it's more something to do with millennials or Generation Y, because there's more to be used about this immediate need of talking.
Everyone has followers. Everyone's got these followers, and
my generation already, I think, was slightly different in the sense that, I don't know, maybe it's a culture thing as well. I have no idea, but I come from a background where, no, to be a proper nice person, you don't talk too much about yourself. You ask about others, though, and you don't put yourself under the limelight unless others are interested in that. The very concept of something like Twitter or Facebook statuses or Snapchat now, for the little
just
that I know about.
Just self-effacing.
Yeah, it's just I decide now to put myself on this stage or on that stage or on that stage, and for whoever wants to see me, I'm there. And I mean,
and the more followers you get, and the more likes you get, the more valued you find your own vapid thoughts to be.
Again, that's a very risky position to...
I just think it's a waste. It's not risky, but it's just a waste. Like,
it is, but...
There are other ways. Like, if you want your own internal thoughts and your own internal feelings to be put out there and to have value to other people, make something.
I always thought that as well. When I realized that I personally didn't have the talent to put out stuff, I decided to try and do my best to be a means for other people to get out there.
I disagree. I would say that you have this view on the world. And you not even necessarily a view, you have these questions, and these questions mean a lot to you. The answers to these questions mean a lot to you, and so...
But again,
your job,
so it's not necessarily relevant.
Yeah, but you're sharing it with other people.
Yeah.
So it's like, okay, well, the thing that I can do is that I have these questions, I have these answers that I care about, and you know what? I think that they're more important than people understand. They're more important than people realize. And they should get a chance, if they choose to listen to these answers and listen to these questions, because it might bring up something that never occurred to them.
Yeah. True, but again,
the answers might...
It's not that there... I don't feel... Ironically, I don't feel that there's an I in the concept itself, because, again, maybe you never talked about something just because nobody ever asked you. And I know that I wouldn't have myself, but there are so many... Like, I remember... This is something really weird. One day, I was just traveling on a motor road, just looking outside, and I just come up point blank with this statement that is like, do you think that rocks have aspirations of gravity? Like, one day I will have my own moon or something like that. So, it's that kind of weird stuff that I have it, other people must have it as well.
No, that's the thing. No, they don't.
Why not?
Because
I'm the basic and then you build up.
No, everyone's different. Again, you cover... That's the thing. It's not about better or worse. It's that you cover one side of a spectrum.
Okay.
And other people cover another side of the spectrum. And it's important for everyone, if they feel like that their side of the spectrum is not being represented, to... If there are no voices, you should become that voice. You have a responsibility to become that voice, because there might be people who feel alone.
Yeah.
There might be people like you going, what, no one else thinks that? No one else thinks these questions? And then suddenly hear someone asking these questions like, thank you, finally!
No,
like,
I always felt lucky in music because of that, because there always is in the end someone that feels like speaks your language.
Hmm.
Or maybe they don't actually, but the way that you receive it again, because the interpretation then goes to you or whatever you want to see in it, makes you feel like, oh, maybe that means exactly what I think, so that actually means that I'm not alone. And again, because of poetry and metaphors, it's, I think the younger you are, the easier it is to project yourself in it.
That's not necessarily true.
I don't know, it got harder for me in time. When I go back and look at songs, listen to songs that I thought at the time meant the world to me and were describing exactly what I was going through, I sort of actually do see now, and I'm like, those were the angsty lyrics of a teenager who didn't know any better, except they were written actually at the time by a 30 or something years old. But
yeah, that was always my thing with Linkin Park. Like, I fucking loved Linkin Park when I was 12 years old, and then suddenly you listen to the lyrics now and it's like, listen to me! Why does no one listen to me?
Yeah.
Oh, stop telling me what to do! Very, very pertinent at 12 years old.
Yeah, exactly. And it's always impressive that sometimes with musicians there's this level of age that
I think
stops at some point, and then I suppose the way you grow sort of stops and just intensifies in what you're looking at the moment you're becoming public property, I suppose.
Yeah.
Because there is a part of life that at the point just gets taken away from you as an experience, because you're the... I suppose that might be part of the reason why Nick Cave might have wanted to just cut himself off the part of Nick Cave, the persona, the singer-songwriter, the character, and just recluding himself to Brighton, where it was normal for everyone to see just him around, and he was just one of the people.
And to learn not to approach him, because if you do, you will get your neck bitten out.
I suppose. But yeah, there is a weird...
Again, still the favourite quote from that Vice interview is like, oh yeah, a colleague of mine in Brighton said that you came into a bookstore and just walked in and bellowed, where are your Bibles?
Clearly, I needed right. one.
Oh yeah, well, obviously I needed one.
Sometimes you just need a Bible, don't you, to just consult her. But yeah, it's, again, I do understand that people at any time in history deserve to have a voice. It's just easier for everybody now to be entitled to a voice and to get a way to get out. But again, this is the sort of the last generation, the last 10, 15 years, I suppose, or anyone that has grown at least in the last 10, 15 years.
I think it's worse than that, though. The problem is the people who are from the past few generations, the Generation X or the Baby Boomers, and they've had these opinions that they've kind of kept quiet because it wasn't societally acceptable.
Yeah.
And then suddenly they see someone say something online that matches like something that they always knew, they always believed, but they just kept quiet. And suddenly it becomes okay for these people to be monsters, to just be horrible.
That I don't get.
And we had an experience today on the bus.
Oh God.
And it's like, yeah, you know, you're kind of right. Brexit is to blame for this. Now, both is an altercation on the bus where someone was getting off at the next stop, and someone tried to sit down in the seats next to them, and they asked, "Oh, can you not sit down until I get up because I'm getting off at the next stop?" And this other woman who was going to sit down goes mental and just starts yelling at this person, like, "How dare you say that to me? How dare you say, oh no, I need to stand up until you get off the bus? No, I'm going to sit down whenever the fuck I want to." And from what I can tell, it was the Nigerian woman who wanted to sit down. And I don't know the ethnicity of the other woman, but they were both clearly immigrants to the country.
And she was Arab because she had an hijab.
Okay, now it is interesting how immigrants can suddenly be the most racist people in the world.
I have no perception of it. But again, because I've always come from a background where you don't do to others what you don't want to go through yourself, and being an immigrant myself, it would have never occurred to me. Like I cannot picture a situation in which I would have said, I know, I want people that are not from here out, because I know that implies me as well.
Because the conversation basically went, what country are you from where you think it's okay to say that to people? In this country, you don't say things like that. You don't do that. Well, to be fair, in this country, you don't scream at people on a bus.
Yeah.
And she eventually, literally physically threw the woman off of the bus at the next stop, pushed her out of the doors, and said, get off this bus, get out of this country.
That is the first time, actually, that I felt the fear that all the Europeans had the day after the vote on Brexit went for yes, and they were like, oh, maybe I was looking around myself, feeling like maybe today I'm not wanted here. And I was like, oh, come on, don't be ridiculous. That's not what happened. I mean, we've been here for however long. And the good thing I always perceived about the UK is that as long as you stick to our social rules, you're one of us. It doesn't matter where you come from, which, given my surname, was a very good thing for me. At the time, especially. So seeing something like that was like, oh fuck, were they right? Should I watch my back?
Well, that's the issue, is that 52% of people basically said that European people don't have the right to live in the UK. I know that's not the majority of the reason for the vote, but that's potentially one of the results of the vote. And it's a horrible potential for the vote to go. And people voted for it anyway. And I think that just awakened a lot of things in people.
You know what?
Of like, oh, well, 52% of the people said it, so it's okay.
You know what? That's the crazy thing, though. In a way, I understand the fact that, you know what? I wouldn't do the same thing, but you were born here, your parents were born here and everything. You decide that this being your country, you don't want me here. You sort of have a right to say so, because I'm the guest. However, being a guest, I cannot be the one treating badly other guests myself. So in a way, I do not condone, but you know what? You have more rights than certainly I have to decide if you like or not people that were not here when you started off being here, and started off as in your culture, your life, your family, and everything. I wouldn't think necessarily the same. I come from Italy. I wouldn't necessarily think the same thing about people coming to Italy, but I suppose I've heard people from Italy going on the same thing, and I'm like, well, same way I went thinking, I don't think it's right. I wouldn't ask people to leave, but you know what? It's their land, their family, their property, so yeah, they must have a say in that. And instead, feeling no, there's this war between paupers, basically.
I mean, we got a friend who works as a temp, and there's a woman in her office that achieved citizenship, so that meant she was eligible to vote. She had British citizenship, and she voted to leave, because essentially the mentality was, okay, now I'm in. No one else is allowed in either.
It doesn't make sense. Like, she wouldn't have gone in.
But it's okay. People like you, we're not talking about people like you, we're talking about the other ones. And yeah, and it's, the problem is with things like, with social media websites like Facebook and Twitter is, and Tumblr especially, is that because people choose to follow you based off of your ideas, and you follow them back, or you friend them back.
There is an echo
chamber. Eventually you just end up in an echo chamber where you suddenly believe that everyone else around you thinks the exact same way as you.
So you must be right.
You're in your own closed off little bubble that no one else in the world can see, and it's so separate from what the internet was supposed to be. We did the internaut tag, the 25-year anniversary of the World Wide Web, last week, or the week before. And the whole point of that was like, hey, remember when we used to just speak to random people?
Yeah.
People from other cultures that we would never have a chance in the world to ever encounter. I mean, that's how we met as a couple, is even like within one of these closed bubble systems. So we met on OkCupid, where they use a mileage radius around you. So you choose to see people within 25 miles of you. And I just so happened to be in London that weekend.
From different countries.
So I'm in London for one weekend, and I decide to punish myself by going, okay, so what could I have if I went on OkCupid in London? Oh, great, cool. And I saw your profile, but I was just kind of, you know, browsing. I wasn't really seriously looking. And yet, you know, we speak for 5 minutes, and suddenly it's like, okay, crap, I'm moving to London.
You knew already that you were going to take over my flat.
Yeah, no, yeah, that was the plan the entire way.
Entire time. Yeah,
I was kind of homeless at the time, to be fair.
I love you anyway.
But I'd rather have stayed homeless than, like, just randomly moving with anyone. No, like, you were, again, it wasn't just a home, you were someone worth uprooting my entire life for. I happened upon, what was it, half an hour after you created your account?
Yeah.
Like, the chances of us actually meeting, I mean, obviously,
they
ended up being 1-to-1, because we did, but
very, very skim, especially with the experiences I was coming from, like,
yeah.
And you could tell from my profile that I was just like, piss off, and don't you dare talking to me, unless you check all these boxes, and also say please while you do it, possibly. Got lost.
I used to have friends across the world. I used to have friends in 3 of the continents.
Wow.
That doesn't exist anymore.
No.
I mean, I know air travel is very cheap, and if you have the capability or the mentality, you can travel the world and you can meet people as you do so, but it was everyone's world back, you know, kind of 10, 15 years ago, and suddenly...
What, you know what's bad to say, but I think has influenced this in some ways. At the time, like in the 90s, if you ended up being able to be online and have the knowledge to do that, that already naturally puts you amongst other people that weren't the norm.
Yes.
Weren't the default.
People who are already seeking out others in the rest of the world because they can't find it at home.
Exactly. Now the internet is a default for everyone, so ironically, it's more representative of the actual world, and being more representative of the actual world, it's more divided.
I would say the internet is killing art. And now I know that, like, we use the internet. The internet is the only reason we can do what we do.
Yeah.
But when it comes to original pieces of art, because of the internet, everyone has this, like, interwoven life with everyone else. And so everything becomes a parody of everything else. And everyone thinks that their version of the thing that they're doing is the version that should be an improvement on things. And that very rarely is the case. As opposed to someone who cuts themselves off from the world, truly experiences and feels what it is to be them. Like, they don't have any other outlet other than to turn it into something incredible. Assuming they have the talent. But you know what? There are very untalented artists who turn a soup can
into an installation, or, you know.
Hey, nobody did it before.
Yeah, I know.
If
that's
anybody
like the
could do
route.
It, then why did you do it first?
I know
first?
The cardinal rule is to do it first.
It's Columbus egg.
Yeah.
But I don't know. One thing that was, I'm gonna say something that, as usual, reveals my age or the age that I feel at least. In my day, there was already the feeling, I think, that you had two choices to stand out. Whether you found a way to do something special, which might have meant working on stuff, reading books, making a culture for yourself, and then finding something new to add or some new perspective to give, or unfortunately the play the victim card was already there. So I can have sympathy or I can have attention, and
yeah,
they both sort of manifest in a similar way.
I know human nature hasn't changed, but the tools given to
make
human
it,
nature
yeah,
have...
make it easier to just go for sympathy now anyway.
Yeah.
And that's really sad, because yes, it's, I mean, as long as you want attention, you can have attention and pity are the same thing, as long as you just want people to turn around and look at you. However, I do feel like they are very different things to be given to someone. And that difference means a lot to me. Ironically, though, and that's what I find most ironic, actually. At the time, back in the day, back at the beginning of the internet, again, you made friends, and because they were friends, I suppose you cared about what they thought, because you spent the time getting to know them. You knew that they were that they were someone that deserved your respect to some degree or in some level, and so you cared about their opinion because of that. And that is what stuck with me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I'm one of the few people, unfortunately, that I know that has never been affected by random trolls or random hate on the internet, because the anon...
You run into it once or twice.
Hmm?
You run into it once or twice.
Yeah, but it never affected me.
No,
like,
yeah,
it never bothered me. I was like, you're a stranger. The fact that you tell me that you don't like me for some reason doesn't really say
it's
anything.
It's a very limited viewpoint that other people have.
But a lot of people get, on YouTube especially, is one of the main things when you get hate comments, and I'm like, why someone that doesn't know me feels so strongly about me in a bad way? And so now the things have turned around, and no, it's not necessarily...
Nobody gives a shit what anyone else thinks of them anymore.
No.
But they just want the attention.
Yeah, and...
It doesn't matter what attention they get, whether it be positive or negative.
Yeah.
Because you got... What was that YouTube comedian who just decided... I say comedian... Who decided to spout hateful bullshit for like 3 or 4 episodes before?
Oh my god!
She nearly actually got killed, I think. Like, someone actually hunted her down for the shit she was saying.
Oh, is that Nicole Harbour?
Nicole Harbour, yeah. Like, she went on these rants about like how much she fucking hates fat people and.
You know what? Ben Cook here in the UK did the same thing. It was the one that was doing Becoming YouTube, and he did the last episode, I think. So far, at least, that was very clearly addressed to main YouTube viewers, knowing that that was exactly the audience that he was going to, and ironically expressing very openly how much distaste he had for them, and they all thought that he was acting, that the...
Mm-hmm.
The video was scripted and he was just acting. So he basically got to tell people how much he despises them and got people to be in it for it to watch it, to be insulted basically, because they felt, no, that's entertainment. It doesn't actually mean to insult me.
And
I'm the clever one out of this bunch.
To be fair though, that's like people who get front row at a comedy show. Like, you sit in the front row, you're gonna get roasted.
Yeah. But again, it's the concept that they have, oh no, you're talking shit, you're right talking shit about all these other bunch of shitty people. Not, of course you're not talking about me.
I mean, hey, let's bring this, keep this on topic. So, there are even comedians who have managed to tell truth from their own lives through their art. And I think number one of that being, I know it's a cliche, but Bill Hicks. Now, Bill Hicks was someone who, he became popular in the kind of underground comedy scene because he started off when he was like 18. And basically the drunker you got him and the more drugs you gave him, the more insane he would get. And he would invent these characters. And he would just spend, sometimes he would spend an entire, like an hour and a half playing these characters and no one could get him off stage because he was just too off his tits. He was just out of his mind. And he just became notorious as this guy who went fucking insane on stage because you gave him drink and you gave him drugs. And then he sobers up and suddenly he has a career. So the first show he ever did was after he completely quit drinking, completely quit all drugs. He still smoked, and he made a big point about smoking in his stand-up show. But his entire comedy routine was kind of, you know, it's the same lines of George Carlin. It was very inspired off of his own experiences and his own experiences against what society told him his experiences should be. And very much based off of common sense, even. Or at least what common sense was to him. Especially with drugs, like his whole thing was that, well, I've had some great experiences on drugs, I've had some terrible experiences of drugs. I wouldn't tell you whether or not you should take drugs or shouldn't take drugs. It's up to you to do whatever you want to do with your life. And unfortunately, yeah, he ended up dying of cancer because of all the drugs. But no, people have these stand-up comedians that are essentially prophets to them because, I don't know, these people delve into the darkest depths of humanity because you don't have to. And they show you...
Mark Twain said the same thing about poets.
Yeah. Well, there we go.
Literally the same thing. Poets are the one that goes to the deepest depths of the human spirit and then come back and tell you the story so that you don't have to.
Yeah. Well, personally, I don't think we're going to get any better than that.
No.
So, okay, well, this was very fun. I'm very nearly out of... Oh, wait, oh.
That's good now.
No, I'm out of wine.
So, as soon as you sober up, you... Well, you don't need to edit this.
No, I'll do this next... This will be out next Friday.
But, yeah, it will be out on YouTube, and so you're not just seeing this...
So, streaming people, nice to meet you. If you enjoyed our drunken conversation, you can find us on YouTube at Gin and Teacups.
UK.
UK. If you're watching this on YouTube, then do pay attention to Facebook and Twitter, because we will be doing this again. Whatever the next time it is, I buy a few bottles of wine. So don't forget to... I mean, if you visit our channel, or if you're watching on our channel right now, don't forget to like and subscribe for more gin in your teacups.
Indeed. And who knows, maybe next time actually join us in our in-depth soul-like conversations.
Where's the stop button?